God is moving, he's releasing, he's a lot of people have been telling me that they've been hearing other ministers say that this is going to be the year of release, and I'm so happy that we drink from one spirit. Amen. That God is talking to many about this year of release, and of course release means a letting go into freedom. The opposite is to restrain, is to hold back. And we know that release is another way to explain forgiveness. That even Father, even in his word, says that those who do not forgive, he cannot forgive, in a way of release, not the forgiveness that you receive from being saved. But God cannot himself even let you go and release you into some things when you do not release, when you do not forgive, and you hold on to certain things, then you actually putting yourself in a stuck position that even God, who wants you to go forth because he gave you your free will, he cannot. But when it's a season of release, then it's not just only God who is releasing us, but if he's releasing us, it means to me and to you that there's finally some things, finally some situations, finally some people that we are going to release. I mean, sometimes it's some things that we don't even know we need to let go. And to let go, to release, in addition to forgiveness, oftentimes it also means when the Lord has been giving us instructions to make room. The same way that you read in the story of Jesus, that for the time of his birth, there was no room in the inn. That's why he was born. In a manger, there was no room in the inn. But also the room that they had prepared, the room that they had prepared in Nazareth, the room that they had made for the birth didn't work. Many times we don't see this part, but they thought they had everything ready. The little baby thing, the little thing that does the thing, the singing thing over here. There was just the perfect bedroom with everything. The perfect color, they had painted, the walls matched the sheets. The blanket had the little thing on it that was matching the curtain. The family had baked cookies that had the same color frosting. They had everything ready. They had measured the time that it would take the woman to come help with the birth. They had everything ready to the T. Because in this season, when we're making room for God, it could also be that some of the room that we have made is not gonna go for what God is bringing our way. So when he says make room for him, for his birth, for whatever he wants, he's bringing, he's releasing in this season, as he's been telling us to look around and make room, it's not necessarily things that we automatically think we don't need. nobody fits something that we thought we needed. And God says, even this that you depend on, I want you to make room for me, because this over here is your comfort zone, and I'm taking you to a place of faith where you haven't been before. I want to make room for you for the much more, but I am limited because you have set forth your room just like they did preparing for Jesus. Sometimes we set things up a certain way. We even think like that. If I do that, then this and that and that, and because I have that and this and that, and I'm gonna let go of this little bed because I'm buying this queen size, and it's gonna go right there on that wall, right next to that lamp, and this is what I've decided to do, and I'm making room for this. And then the Lord might say, I don't even want you to stay in that place. I'm staying here, Lord. I've been making room for this queen size bed since 1954. I'm not moving. And the Lord, he said, I want you to make room. It's beautiful when the Lord, he puts us in a season to make room, because it doesn't always appear to be the way that it really has it. So he's causing us to tune up our ears, our spirit of faith. He's increasing, he's getting us to be really just asking him about every little detail, even the things that you think you do need. So even the things like, well, Lord, I really, really, really need this. And sometimes we don't ask the Lord, Lord, do you want me to give that away? Well, no, we're not going to ask the Lord, do you want me to give that away? Because what if he says yes? So we don't ask him. We already know, I can let go of this, I can let go of that, not that, this, not that. This is okay, not yet, maybe not yet. There's an incredible spirit of giving that is releasing upon the body. And what I find about giving, there's obedience in giving, always. But there's also some crazy things the Lord will cause you to give. How many, I remember when the Lord told me to give my car. How many ever gave a car? See, look at all these hands. Look around. Look at all these hands. Well, did you need the car? I heard one no, and I heard one. When I gave my car, that was the only car, was my little Pinto. And I was ministering in the radio station, and I'm literally ministering the word, and there's a lady there, and I didn't even know she needed a car. And I'm praying like I pray for you guys. I didn't know the Lord was going to tell me to do something. I'm praying for the lady. And I hear out of my mouth. And the Lord wants me to give you my car. And I said it so fast because when it comes to hearing God, you don't even have time to think of it. You can't reason with it. You know, it's like there's an anointing that comes upon you, and the Lord causes you to walk through this supernatural realm that it's only when you go home and you think, what happened? I gave my car. Why? I remember going to the store, having saved money, buying a computer. In the car, leaving the store. After after having saved money for the computer, all happy. I had my computer in the car, leaving my call center. Drive by so-and-so, the computer is for them. Supernatural realm comes upon me on that car. Knock at the door. And did it really quick, you know, like Abraham obeyed. Whoop, he rose quickly, like hurry up, like knock at the door. Here, the Lord told me to give you these blessings. Because you don't want to have anything. Because even the person that you led to give could try to talk to you out of your giving. That you try to bless somebody with something and they're like, no, I really don't need, no, you need it more than I do. No. The Lord told me to give it to you. Doesn't necessarily mean that you need it. In other words, he said to give you the computer, it's not because you have one or you don't. It's just to obey. Hallelujah. And of course, the Lord, he blesses you and blesses you, but it's to give you example that when we're in a season to making room for God, don't be surprised if he puts you in a supernatural realm and cause you to give. I'm not talking to give what you think you can release. But to give what you thought you should hold on to. Hallelujah. So, it's quiet. Everybody's thinking, oh my gosh, what do I have? What God could possibly... Well, if he says to do that, okay. Oh God, I should have come to church tonight. Because now I heard that word. No, I'm just playing. A lot of you, he already did that, didn't he? Many, many, many times. There's a story I'm reminded of when God, I don't remember, I think it's in, Second King, you remember when God told this lady who was dying? Oh yeah, here it is in chapter 4 of Second King. We read the story of Elisha and the widow's oil. And a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets cried out to Elisha, saying, your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant feared the Lord, and the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be his slaves. And so Elisha said to her, what shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in your house? Well, men of God, you didn't hear me. Why are you asking me what I have? I come to ask you, what can you do for me? You asking me what I have? He says, tell me, what do you have in your house? And she said, your maidservant has nothing in the house but a jar of oil. And then he said, go, borrow vessels from everywhere, from all your neighbors, empty vessels. Do not gather just a few. Do not gather just a few. Do not gather just a few. Obey. Don't gather just a few. Don't make room for a little God. He says, and when you have come in, you shall shut the door behind you and your sons, then pour it into all those vessels and set aside the full ones, meaning there should be some empty left. So she went from him and shut the door behind her and her sons who brought the vessels to her, and she poured it out. And now it came to pass when the vessels were full that she said to her son, bring me another vessel. And he said to her, there is not another vessel. So the oil ceased. Then she came and told the man of God, and he said, go, sell the oil and pay your debt, and you and your sons leave on the rest. In other words, I'm going to bless you with what you have. I'm going to do what is needed to do. But as you make room, he was saying, I told you not to just bring a few. In other words, there could have been even more. And now we're in a season of the much more. That God is stirring up a spirit of faith like you have never walked in, a childlike faith. A faith that doesn't look at what you don't have, but a faith that looks at what you have and is willing to even let go of that if that's required, because you know that even the little one coin that you have belonged to him. And to be able to ask him, Lord, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? Because you can multiply what's in my hand. Just because of who you are, as long as I willingly let you have it in my heart. Many times he will see if he can have it from your heart. He's not interested in hand giving. He's looking for heart giving. Hand giving can be easier than heart giving. Heart giving is when it's the last thing you have and he causes you to give it. I remember one day when he told me to give this lady in church this beautiful outfit that I had just... And I was keeping it to wear at a special occasion. I didn't know the special occasion was give it to her. When he said give it to her, my first thought as you're growing in obeying the Lord is, Lord, I thought that was for me. I don't have that outfit. Has anybody been there? And not just for material things, but when the Lord calls you to love on someone that's really been treating you wrong. And you walk in church and he said, I want you to go love on her. I said, Lord, you mean her? No. Lord, you really mean her? But you know, Lord, you heard what she told me. You saw the way she looked at me. Then you can find yourself talking to the Lord, questioning the Lord. Lord, do you really want me to do that? And then you grow in faith, and then you know you're going to obey. Because I remember when I didn't obey, and then I would go back to my chair. I couldn't hear the word. I couldn't do nothing. All I kept on hearing, I told you. Go love on her. And then you find out with God, he means now. Like, he doesn't mean, you know, next week when you come, or, you know, he just means now. And until you obey, you're going to sit there and just be like, Miss Abel. And he stirs you up to hear his voice and do it. When it calls you to even give, to make room, like he did with the Shunammite woman who made room for the prophet in the upper room. I wonder what the husband said. How many times somebody needs a place, another man of God, and you're going to give them the room? Well, yes, we're giving them the womb. I thought I was going to have a son. I never got pregnant. We don't need this womb that we got for a boy or a girl. I've been barren. So Elisha's going to stay up there. We have the extra room. We bought this nice little house with an extra room for a baby. There's none, so we may as well use the room. The Lord say, make the room for the man of God. And you know the story. She makes the room for the man of God. So that the man of God then, he asked the servant, Gehazi, what does she need? What can I do for her? Because she made room for me. When you make room for God, it could be in your prayer time. It's not always material things. I'm giving you different example. It could be when the Lord tells you to pray for somebody else and you're sitting here in need of major breakthrough, miraculous prayer. And the Lord says, I want you to go pray. As soon as my breakthrough comes, I pray for them. Lord, I will have such an anointing on me when the testimony comes through. Lord, if you would hurry up and bring me my breakthrough, I could pray for them like I've never prayed before. There will be an anointing of faith, my God, when you come through for me. There's something incredible about making room for God, because he calls you to do something before the next car come, before the next computer come, before somebody blesses you with 5 outfits. Before, when you pray for somebody else, the very thing that they ask you to pray for is the thing that you need, and you set free while you pray for them. Cause you to give time when you don't have any. What do you mean, volunteer at the church? My mates don't even know what I look like. He calls you to obey. And Elisha asked Gehazi, what does she have need of? And he said, well, she doesn't have a son. The womb. The womb that she made for the work of God. God, in exchange, he made room for what she even had lost hope for. He looked at Gehazi and he told Gehazi, tell. And he looks at her and he says, next year at this time, you will have a son. Don't lie to me. She said, I'm not doing that for anything in exchange. I'm not making room for what I think you're going to do. I'm just making room because God told me to make room. Don't lie to me. Because see, there's a principle that I see in this season that many have been planting and sowing to the spirit that you are going to reap things that you have even deep down lost hope for. That deep down. Maybe on the outside you can say, I still believe, but I'm talking deep down. I'm talking with only God here, with only God. No, and I'm talking 100% hope, not a little bit of faith, you understand? I'm talking great faith. Great faith. And it's interesting because that's what the vessels represent us. It represents us. And the enemy always attack to hinder people from being available. He always attacks with a whole bunch of things so that when God says something, well, now? I can't now. She was knocking at the door. The sons were knocking at the door. It would be like now somebody knocking at your door and saying, hey, you have an extra garage? What do you need it for? I don't know. I don't know your neighbors, but my neighbors, they would pick up the phone and call. This lady, she's going cuckoo. Bananas. When God calls you to obey, it's never for what you think he asks you to obey. He asks his people just to see if they would respond in obedience. And then he shows up. It's an Abraham that's told, go give up your son. And God, when he sees he's willing, no, behold the ram, I have another way. You kidding? Do you know what I went through for 2 days? 3 days? Walking on the top of the mountain, I didn't even know what mountain you want me to go. I left my servants behind. My wife is mad at me. Sarah is never gonna talk to me again. You tell me to bring Isaac right after I let go of Ishmael, had to leave him and Hagar. I spent all this time, I stayed at the bottom of the mountain because I didn't know exactly where you wanted me to go. Every Sunday I was going to church. God, give me a word. God, give me a word. God, give me a word. I did all that. And you didn't even want me to do that? No, my child, I just wanted to see if from your heart you were willing to give whatever I require of you. Because much is given, much is required. And what I give is often after you give what's required. You don't even know. It could be even something, a gift that you have to do something, and you prepare to do it, and then the Lord, he opens a whole different door with a whole other gift. It could be you who don't think you have any gift. And God calls you to obey and to do a simple thing. And then, boom, don't you love how God works? He works in incredible ways. When the Shunammite woman, I know I'm going through all these stories, but I'm just flowing. Boop, they're all, boom. Because they're all stories that talk about the same kind of thing. But when the Shunammite woman, her son was born, but you remember one morning the son died. Oh, the son died. And she had to really, because in the process of everything that had happened, she got such a faith that she didn't have at the beginning. She had faith for the womb to be used by the men of God, but she didn't have faith to have a child because she was too old, barren, whatever. I don't know if anybody here ever wanted a child and somebody told you you couldn't, but just think. Okay. So the womb that was made, she made but without that much faith. She made it for the man of faith. But she herself didn't have faith. She made the room for him. And in the process, when she saw the work of God and the miraculous, then when her son died, oh, you talk about faith. You talk about faith. I don't know what you've seen God do in your life in this past season, that God is saying, I have worked in you such a faith. I have given you such a faith that in this season you will see what I have prepared you for. You'd have not seen it yet. You don't know what it is. But trust me, my children, what I have is even much greater. It's above what you can ask or think, and it's going to be in such a way that I will be glorified, because people will look at you and know this is a child of God. There is no way that this person can walk in that without belonging to God. Hallelujah. There is no way. The Lord has got this incredible, incredible faith. So when the son dies, she just picks up the dead child. She do not talk to anyone. And she runs with such a faith to the man of God, to where it comes from, and with faith, bound and determined, she takes the child, she takes him to the room that she had originally made for the child, but then she used it for Elisha. The child was born, now the child is dead, but she takes him up. She puts him on the bed and she shut the door. Oh my God. Oh my God. And she runs to the man of God and said, I told you not to lie to me. And she doesn't give up, because the kind of faith that you're going to walk in this season is going to be the faith that goes to the Lord for every little thing, that do not give up. The prayers of the righteous that avail much, the prayers that don't give up, the prayers that somebody can stay up all night and say, Father, I believe. The prayers that tip the bowls in heaven. You see the prayers that when there's enough incense, you see them, they just tip the bowl. I don't know what tip the bowl of the prayers in heaven. Oh God. Hallelujah. But you see them in Revelation when it talks and it says, and then suddenly they gathered, right? Prayers, and they put it in the bowl. You don't know what happens. Suddenly, whoop, a prayer tipped the bowl. And the answer come. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Do we sometimes fall short of vessels? Do we sometimes, God is, he's about to say, behold the ram. But no, what if Abraham would have said, no, God told me to kill him. Rebuke you, Satan. God told me. Because you always have to be willing to listen. And you have always to be ready to humble yourself and be able to hear new instruction, new direction. For everything, when you make room for God. Just like David did, he inquired of the Lord. Just like you see over and over again. And you remember, since I'm in the neighborhood, I remember another story, since we have Christmas around the corner, and it's Zacharias, Elizabeth's husband. The angel come at the time of offering, of giving. The angel come. The angel tells Zacharias, hey, this is the greatest day of breakthrough in your life, and your prayers have been heard, and Elizabeth is going to have a child, going to have a son, and this is going to be his name. He's going to be John, which means God is gracious, and this is going to happen. Now I'm Gabriel. He questioned it. He didn't believe it. You know what happened? In 2 Corinthians, we read the scripture that says we have the same spirit of faith. We believe, therefore we speak. Well, he didn't believe, therefore, he didn't speak. Zip. Shut his mouth. But you know what's amazing that I want you to, oh God, thank you, Holy Spirit, is that he shuts his mouth, but the word that he brought was so true that the child was born in spite. Catch this. Hallelujah! Catch it. The same spirit of faith couldn't stop. John the Baptist was to be born. And this is going to be a season that even where some of us have had an unbelief in any area, the spirit of faith going to loose your tongue, loose your voice, loose your prayers, loose you. And you're going to be able, whatever he tells you, you're going to be able to say, I believe, and therefore I speak. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And then there's some things that sometimes the enemy tells us, well, it's because of so and so unbelief. No. The Lord says maybe it hinder you from witnessing and speaking for a season. But what I'm bringing in your life is going to bring forth your testimony and your witnessing back in your life. Well, where you have been keeping quiet because even you yourself were questioning, the Lord says, oh, I'm going to do it in such a way. John the Baptist was born. Well, how can you not believe it? Now suddenly, not only his tongue is loose,
but God says, what am I saying? Wait a minute.
Who are you? Because that spirit of faith. My God, I'm telling you tonight that there's some things that we have received that in this season is causing you to release. Receive, you give. The more you receive, the more you give. It's not the more you give. It's the more you receive, the more you give. And that in this season, he's releasing such a spirit of faith that you are going to be able to make room based on whatever he tells you to do. Because you know and you believe in your heart that whatever you're about to receive is incredible because it comes from God. It's a beautiful thing. It's an incredible thing to be born for such a time as this. It's incredible. God did that at his first coming. And he came. He was born to die. He conquered. He rose on the third day. He's the head of the body. Then on Pentecost, the church was born. The body was born. The body's here. Now, I wonder if this God, through his body, would do kind of the same, even greater works than he did. Greater works, shall you do? God is going to just release just incredible, crazy instructions according to the world. There's some people that are about to regain their voice back. And there's some people that are going to see vessels that now they're preparing, making room for the Lord. They're going to see an incredible anointing and provision being released. And some of you in this past season that have made room for the things of the Lord, but you haven't seen any fruits, and you really didn't look for them because you were just knowing that you just needed to obey. This is the season that you are going to reap. The Lord says, do not grow weary in well-doing. In due season, you shall reap. This is the season of reaping. Hallelujah. And you have sown, and he's going to ask you to sow some things. And it's going to be just an incredible season. My God, lift up your hands. Say, I believe. Therefore I speak. I receive. All that I have in Christ. I release it. I give it. In obedience. Father, here I am. Speak to me. I come to you for every little detail, what I don't need, what I need. I don't know anymore. All I know is here I am. I give you myself. Do as you will. I surrender all, and I expect above and beyond what I can ask or think. Have your way, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Put your hand on your belly. I love when people get the word. Put your hand in your belly. Say, I'm pregnant with greatness. God has great things for me. Because I carry a great God, and he carries me. I'm expecting. Hallelujah! How many people came in here tonight not pregnant and you're living pregnant?
Amen.
I feel there's such a spirit of faith in this house that, yes, I hear you, Holy Spirit. Hold on. Everybody close your eyes as the Lord, what he wants you to give. I never ask you to give, but I hear the Lord says, whoop. So I say, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to give? Yes, Lord, I will obey.